3 days into the new year, it's not too late to start afresh and adopt a new mindset as we confront the challenges and seize the opportunities of 2014 head on. Hello and welcome to Jamaica Magazine. I'm Adrian Atkinson. On the show today, tips on ensuring your new wheels. And for pedestrians, reminders as you conduct your daily transactions. Those and much more in just a few minutes.
We must keep focused on the gains that we will make along the way, the development goals that we will reach.
On the gains made during Jamaica's Jubilee year, the Portia Simpson Miller-led administration made strategic plans to further enhance the island's development agenda in 2013. Catch highlights of the Prime Minister on a mission this Monday, January 6, right here on this station. Good day, I'm Samantha Allen, and this is your GIS News for Friday, January 3. The National Security Ministry is implementing a series of interventions in violence-prone communities. The ministry is collaborating with the Peace Management Initiative, the JCF's Community Safety and Security Branch, the Violence Prevention Alliance, and the Umbrella Group of Churches. The interventions include corner league football competitions, outdoor church services, and increased community policing to engage residents in peaceful and fun activities. Started at the end of last year, the activities are designed to galvanize support for community peace building. That's part of the three-pronged approach to dealing with crime, launched in December and dubbed Unite for Change. The Ministry of Education is to launch a pilot project later this month for the revision of the school curriculum for grades 1 through to 9.
There is a tremendous economic and pedagogic opportunity for our teachers, for our educators, to write the material for the new curriculum, one that treasures who we are as a people. Yes, which reflects our best aspirations for the future and the competences connected with that.
The minister added that 2014 was the year for student achievement and said that as part of those efforts, a new high school would be opened in September. Through the use of technology, teachers from a prominent high school will deliver lectures to the students at the new school. Minister Thwaites made the announcement Thursday at the launch of the Caribbean Virtual Academy, which will assist students sitting external exams at the primary and secondary level.
We regard SIVA at the ministry as complementary, not competitive, complementary to classroom-based teaching and learning, as it provides the opportunity for students to learn at their own pace and not to hamper those who are capable of managing the curriculum at a quicker pace.
In the meantime, the Education Minister will be meeting with representatives from the Ministry of Science, Technology, Energy and Mining to assess the e-learning project.
In this instance, it's not a question of a shortage of funds. The Universal Access Fund is able to afford what we're doing, but we have to develop the content.
The minister is calling on internet service providers to ensure that all Jamaicans, regardless of their geographical location, have access to the internet. Meanwhile, the Creative Production and Training Center, which falls under the Ministry of Youth and Culture, will be partnering with the Education Ministry to offer 24-hour educational content for television. The Youth and Culture Ministry has received a $500,000 donation to assist children in the care of the Child Development Agency, the CDA. The donation was made Monday by former West Indies cricket captain Brian Lara. A portion of the funds will also be used to assist a 15-year-old girl who is in need of a vital surgery. Portfolio Minister Lisa Hanna thanked Mr. Lara for his contribution and said the money would go a far way in offsetting the expenses of the young girl's surgery. The former West Indies cricket captain said the donation formed part of the work he wished to do to assist with the development of children and youth. And finally, residents of Portland will be happy to hear that a strong cross-sectoral team has been named to urgently examine operations at the Buff Bay Hospital and craft a development plan. The news comes after a commitment from Health Minister Dr. Fenton Ferguson that the state of the Buff Bay Community Hospital would get urgent attention. Dr. Ferguson has named a 12-member committee with instructions to start working immediately in coming up with a plan. The Buff Bay Hospital Special Committee has Chief Medical Officer Dr. Kevin Harvey as chairman, with representatives drawn from the Ministry of Health Head Office, the Northeast Regional Health Authority, and technical persons from the parish level. The 100-year-old hospital was downgraded to community hospital status in 1985 under a rationalization program. Derelict buildings feature prominently on the spacious compound, and Dr. Ferguson says that as a first step, the committee may want to consider planning for the demolition of some of these structures. And that's it for GIS News today. I'm Samantha Allen. Thanks for watching.
I needed help to expand my business, but the banks only wanted to be up in my business. The high interest rates were killing my business. They're never really business with my business.
At the Exim Bank, we have your business needs covered. Our application process is easy, and we provide loans at competitive rates for the productive sector. From renewable energy projects and working capital to plant upgrades or expansion and export financing. Come in and talk to us today. The Exim Bank. On the road to success, you are going to want us in your business.
As long as you own a motor vehicle, you can't get away from the insurance costs associated with those wheels. But there are certain things you can do to minimize the premium. Find out more next.
Tires began to screech. A cacophony of horns could be heard howling some sort of warning. They were followed by a tirade of abuse and high-pitched rambling from drivers. Then, deafening silence. It was the unexpected. Another motor vehicle accident that could transform lives into a huge tangled mess of despair. Luckily, there was a safety net, auto insurance.
Auto insurance is used to protect motorists against each other, as well as to protect themselves for damage to their vehicles or to their passengers.
And apart from the protection it provides, Paragraph 4, Section 1 of the Motor Vehicles Insurance Third Party Risks Act states that it is illegal for any person to use a motor vehicle on the road unless a policy of insurance is in place. This will ensure that if a traffic accident occurs, the victims, motorists, pedestrians, and passengers, have some form of compensation for their loss. There are three main types of insurance policies for motor vehicles.
There's third party only, which is the one that's required by law, and that's the one that covers the other guy. It covers your passengers and it covers everybody else on the road. Your vehicle is not covered and you, the driver, are not covered.
Third-party theft and fire offers added protection, ensuring that motorists are compensated if their vehicles are stolen or destroyed by fire.
And then you have comprehensive, which is everything rolled into one. So you're getting fire coverage for your vehicle, theft coverage for your vehicle, and collision coverage for your vehicle, as well as a protection against you accidentally hitting somebody else on the road.
Based on the type of insurance policy, a number of factors may determine one's premium, the sum of money paid out to the insurance company. Factors include the age and the type of vehicle, the age of the policyholder and the driver of the vehicle, or the claims history of the driver.
Somebody with a list of accidents behind their name is going to have a higher premium than somebody without one. So, as I said before, it's a case-by-case situation, and even though there's a general guideline that most insurers will follow in each insurance company, everybody's assessed individually.
The lesson in context, drive carefully. Now, there are other things you can do to lower the cost of your auto insurance. Shop around, compare premiums and benefits offered by insurance companies. Practice defensive driving, drive for yourself and others, and if possible, restrict the number of persons allowed to drive your vehicle. If you live alone, you can consider allowing yourself and a close family member or friend to drive your vehicle. Restriction will attract a lower premium as opposed to an open policy where anyone with your permission can drive the motor vehicle. Another thing you can do to lower your auto insurance is to suspend your policy if you will be off the island for an extended period of time. That's if no one else will be allowed to drive the vehicle. Discuss this with your insurance company, as there is usually some monetary benefit to this type of policy suspension. Installing a tracking device may also reduce your motor vehicle insurance premiums, but do the math. Ensure the tracking device bill isn't more expensive than the money you would save on the premium. You can also negotiate your deductible or excess to lower the insurance premium. A deductible is the amount of money a policyholder pays when there is an accident.
We have it there to avoid the minor fender benders. It would be uneconomical and administratively burdensome to deal with every single ding and dent at an insurance company. Also, we want the policyholder to have a stake in their vehicle.
So if a car values $2 million and the excess is 5% of the value of the vehicle, once the policyholder makes a claim on the insurance policy, he or she would have to contribute $100,000 towards the cost of repairing the vehicle. The excess is, however, refundable if another driver was at fault in the accident and your insurance company was able to settle with that driver's insurance company. To leave financial breathing room, one can also opt to pay their insurance premiums in parts, for example, twice a year. You may end up paying a little more, but at least your savings will not be severely depleted. Note, however, that if there is an accident, you may be required to pay off the premium upfront before you can claim on your policy. Now that we know some of the things we can do to lower the cost of auto insurance, let's turn our attention to what happens if there is an accident.
Take as many pictures as you can, if possible, on the scene of the accident. Two, get all the information for the other party, as much as you can. That's name, who was driving, who owns the vehicle. Again, that's not always the same person. The type of vehicle and any insurance details that you can get. Try and find a witness. Far too often, we don't have enough claims where we have a witness statement, an independent witness. A passenger in your car doesn't count as an independent witness, especially when it's your husband or wife or brother or sister. Then go to the police and report it, and then you must report it to your insurance company.
So why does one's premium go up after an accident? Put it this way, experts say insurance is a pool of funds to which everybody has to contribute. If money from the pool has to be paid out, then the pool has to be readjusted to maintain its balance so that it can adequately compensate all contributors who may suffer a loss.
When you're in an accident and it's going to cost $1 million because somebody's injured and you have to fix the other guy's car, and your premium goes up by $10,000 or $20,000, you're still in the green $980,000. So don't look at it too much as a penalty of your premium going up, but of your contribution to the pool maintaining balance.
From January to June 2013, the motor vehicle insurance industry saw about 16,000 new claims and an increase in personal injury claims due to a change in culture and the legal system. The motor vehicle insurance industry also recorded about 450 thefts from January to June 2013. So, auto insurance is there to compensate victims of traffic accidents. Drive carefully on the roads. Determine the best insurance policy, one that provides adequate coverage while attracting a reasonable premium.
Your tax dollars help to ensure street lights are properly maintained. Are there defective ones in your area? Report them so they can be fixed. Call 1-888-991-4617. Provide the pole number and location of the street light, and the information will be communicated to the JPS. Join in the effort to ensure your tax dollars work for you.
All road users have to be cognizant of the rules to ensure their safety. Up next, a few tips for pedestrians.
Ever wondered where the safest places are to cross the roads? Coming up, tips to help all of us when we walk on the roads. I'm Alyssa Watson, and you're watching Road Scholars.
Pedestrians are among the most vulnerable groups of road users, as traditionally, pedestrians, along with pedal cyclists and motorcyclists, have ranked high on the road fatalities list. When a pedestrian is hit by a motor vehicle, the impact and severity of injury is determined by a number of factors. The size of the vehicle, the speed at which it is traveling, the angle at which impact was made with the individual, as well as what happened when the vehicle came to a stop, all impact the outcome of the crash.
The vulnerability of those who use our roadways makes it critical for the authorities, motor vehicle operators, and pedestrians themselves to take steps to ensure their safety.
It's all a part of creating what is called a traffic-friendly environment, making provisions and instituting certain safety mechanisms, such as calculating the time span between stoplight changes to give vulnerable users more time to cross.
You will have, say, 1 to 1.25 meters per second you calculate for an average person to get across the road, where there is deemed to be a high number of vulnerable road users. Children, elderly, the blind, the disabled, you reduce it to, say, 0.75 meters per second. So you do the calculation, and then you always have a safety factor that you put into it, maybe 25% additional time provided to get pedestrians across.
It's important that all those who use the roads outside of the relative safety of a motor vehicle be considered. So, of course, there are provisions made for the elderly, the deaf, the visually impaired, and other physically challenged individuals.
A traffic-friendly environment for the person itself now. Sidewalks, pedestrian guardrails, pedestrian crossings, having ramps on the sidewalks themselves to provide ease of access. Advanced features in sidewalks, or you might have tactile sidewalks now where the texture of the sidewalk is different from the regular sidewalk for the blind, so that they can feel when they walk to know that right here is where I should cross. You can have audible pedestrian traffic signals now. For example, there was a pilot done by the Halfway Tree Transport Center where when it's your time to walk, you'll actually hear a beep sound. So again, the blind can pick up that it's time for me now to cross this corridor.
Children too are considered in drafting the road code for vulnerable users, which serves as a guide to policymakers. It includes placing crossing guides and traffic wardens in school zones.
In 2010 alone, 32 elderly persons lost their lives due to road crashes, emphasizing the need for groups such as these to be provided for in the layout of the traffic environment.
If the elderly is having problem crossing at the junction or intersection, anybody who is around and who notices it should go and assist them to cross the road by holding their hand and going across the road with them. And this also applies to the children. And in so doing, we'll be reducing the amount of people that get killed by vehicles.
Because of incorrect driving, road infringement, persons failing to apply the road code, approximately 57% of all road accidents and fatalities are caused by this incorrect driving.
Drivers, pedal cyclists, and motorcyclists also need to look out for pedestrians while on their journey. There are certain rules they need to obey for both their safety and that of the pedestrians, like being vigilant, avoiding the use of cellular phones and other electronic devices, cutting their speed, and overtaking only when necessary. In a nutshell, obey all road rules.
Pedestrians can do a lot to ensure that they use the road safely.
Like remembering the 6 steps to use when crossing the road and using them always. Think, is it safe to cross here? Can I see clearly? And can I be seen clearly? Stop. Once you have decided to cross, stop at that spot. Look and listen. Look left and right and listen to see if traffic is approaching. Wait. Ensure the road is fully clear. Cross. Proceed briskly and carefully to the other side. And keep looking and listening. While crossing, look and listen to see if there is any approaching traffic. Some other useful guidelines include wearing light-colored clothing at night. This will allow you to be more clearly seen by other road users. Always walk on the right side of the road towards the oncoming traffic. Make full use of pedestrian crossings, signalized crossing intersections, overhead bridges and other crossing aids as much as possible. Never cross at deep corners where you cannot see vehicles approaching on either side. In areas where there is little or no sidewalk, walk as close as possible to the curb to prevent being hit and avoid being distracted by electronic devices.
Parents are also being encouraged to teach their children some good traffic habits, starting with some simple ones.
Teach them the six-step method of crossing the road. Tell them never to play in the streets. Accompany them to school, the playground, and other areas until they are competent enough to go by themselves. And show them the safest areas to cross the road and teach them to use crossing aids properly. It takes the commitment of everyone working together to ensure all users of the road are granted safe passage. Remember, paying attention to road safety saves time, it saves money, and it saves lives.
Let's all try to make a difference in the traffic environment. Why not join the effort to significantly reduce road fatalities? This has been Road Scholars, and I am Addison Watson. Walk good.
Now's the time for us to say, Happy New Year!
May light always surround you, hope kindle and rebound you. May your hearts turn to healing, your heart embrace feeling. May laughter infect you, your passion resurrect you. May goodness inspire your deepest desires. Through all that you reach for, may your arms never tire. Always remember who we are as a people, and more importantly, whose we are. We are God's mighty army, and we can and shall defeat all the giants as we build our promised land. Happy New Year to all of you.
Happy New Year.
In about April of this year, the Citizen Security and Justice Program, CSJP, will reignite its partnership with the Jamaica Defense Force. As you'll see next, this means several youngsters will get the opportunity to develop their skills set.
It's said that the devil finds work for idle hands. And with illegal quick cash schemes and violent activities being easy distractions for young people, government is ensuring that these young hands are occupied to build life skills and self-esteem and keep the youngsters out of harm's way. And so they arrive at the Jamaica Defense Force JDF headquarters by 8 a.m. Armed with helmets, boots, and recommended garb to match, it's time for a training program that promotes a positive change in attitude while sharpening vocational skills. General construction. Welding. Auto mechanics.
I'm taking the level of oil in the power steering reservoir.
Plumbing. And electrical installation. Just some of the focus areas under the Citizen Security and Justice Program, CSJP's internship program with the JDF at Oak Park Camp. CSJP is a crime and violence prevention initiative which builds the overall safety and security of communities. Part of the prevention strategy involves providing an outlet for young people to support themselves and family, rather than turning to acquisitory crimes like robbery and violent crimes like murder. And so, in 2012, the CSJP began a partnership with the JDF through a memorandum of understanding to offer on-the-job training to hundreds of youngsters. It initially started out as a six-month program, but based on feedback from participants and organizers, it was extended on about two occasions. Over 400 participants are now expected to graduate in December 2013 and receive certificates from CSJP and JDF.
The partnership was born out of the fact that many of the youngsters we observe lack practical experience, and given the current macroeconomic situation, many of them were unable to get jobs.
So since the JDF has a number of construction projects underway at Up Park Camp and CSJP participants need the experience, the partnership allowed those who are already certified to undertake the required tasks. That leaves room for members of the JDF Engineering Regiment to embark on other projects of national importance. The target group is unattached or at-risk youth, persons in the 20 to 35 age group who are certified by the Harsh Trust NTA, have a clean police record, and reside in one of the 50 CSJP communities.
The overall objectives of the program is really to improve the employability of the youngsters. But critically for us also is the improvement in their social skills.
The CSJP also pays a stipend and provides the safety gear for the youngsters, while the Army representatives supervise the participants and the execution of their tasks.
They will come in and whatever it is that their tasks are or their supervisors will pass on to them, they will do whatever that is for the day. And even if they don't know what to do, they'll be coached and told what to do. And eventually they acclimatize or they manage to simulate it, and it works for them in the long run.
One of the good things about this CSJP JDF program is that the participants are being cross-trained, allowed to develop a multiplicity of skills. As part of the crime-fighting strategy, the government has been focused on improving the relationship between the citizens and security personnel, building trust, and reminding persons that a safer Jamaica requires the input of all citizens. Now, through the CSJP program, that relationship is being bolstered as the participants have one-on-one interaction with the soldiers.
Interacting with the soldiers, them, you know, when they are on duty on the road, they are totally different from over here. So getting to know them, they are human beings as well.
Some program participants who had no intention of being in the military even exceeded their individual expectations and decided to apply for a job.
Recruiting has taken place, and you must recognize that the recruiting process for the Jamaica Defense Force is an open process. It is not limited to any individual or group. So even if these individuals were not a part of this program, they could have applied to become a part of the JDF anyway.
A lot of my friends came on the program with not the interest of being in the army. They weren't exactly thinking in that area, but since we have been here, our mentality has changed so much that we have now seen the need to go in the army.
Those friends have since graduated from the JDF training program and are now officially soldiers.
Right now, I want to tell you I'm an all-rounder, right? Because I realize when I'm home, there's no challenge too hard for me to fix it. You understand? So right now, I'm a local Mr. Fix-It.
Before I came here, I was only able to buy a house. Now I'm able to climb posts and stuff.
I was mostly worked on cars and stuff, but now I'm working on being able to work on the trucks and the tractors. I've learned a little more technicality and more teamwork.
My plans are for complete this program is trying to go out there, make myself more marketable and get a job that I can take care of myself and family.
The Ministry of National Security through CSJP and the JDF, transforming the lives of unattached youth to enhance their vocational skills and promote positive behavioral change. It's all part of the broader strategy to beef up social intervention programs, creating opportunities for youngsters while keeping them out of harm's way. This will in turn lead to improved security and safety in communities across Jamaica, allowing the government to fulfill Strategic Priority 3 for the financial year.
And that's a wrap on this Friday's edition of Jamaica Magazine. Thanks for staying with us. Come back tomorrow for another great program on this station. You may send comments to jamaicamagazine@jis.gov.jm. Follow us on Twitter at JIS News and visit our website, jis.gov.jm. On behalf of the entire production team here at the JIS, I'm Adrian Atkinson. Do take care.
This has been a production of the Jamaica Information Service, the voice of Jamaica.